Hello and welcome to this last video of this series of videos about rotor blades. In this last video, we will talk about some construction details of rotor blades.
At first, I want to present the structural design of a wind turbine. The breaking strength of the components must be able to withstand extreme loads, for example, the highest occurring wind velocity. Additionally, the fatigue strength of the components must be guaranteed for the design life of typically 20 to 30 years. The stiffness of the components must be dimensioned. Elastic components usually reduce the material fatigue, but elastic components are also triggered to vibrations by external excitations. And due to this reason, the required stiffness is a design criterion besides sufficient strength. In the case of smaller rotors, thus the ones on the left side of the picture, wind loads dominate the strength design. And in the case of bigger rotor diameters, like the ones on the right side of the picture, the bending moments of the rotor weight is more decisive.
And when we consider that those rotor blades are getting longer and longer, then also the forces are getting more and more dominant. And one of those is the self-weight of the rotor blades. And when we consider the rotation of the rotor blades, then we have alternating tensile and compressive forces in the longitudinal direction of the blade. And when the blade is in this direction, then we have high alternating bending moments around the swivel axis of the blades. And when we consider that the lifetime of a wind turbine is 20 years and more, then we get 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 8 cycles in the lifespan of the plant. And that means that is a really high fatigue strength to the rotor blades. And therefore, a lot is done to reduce the rotor blade weight, and the construction is going towards lightweight construction.
A further mass force is the centrifugal force, which leads to a stationary drag stress. It is calculated by the mass of the rotor blade times the radius until the mass center times the angular velocity to the power of 2. In comparison to the mass force by the self-weight of the rotor blade, this force has a lower importance due to the comparatively low rotational speed.
And the next forces are the spinning forces, and that occurs when we have the rotating rotor moving towards a new wind direction in those directions. Then we have the tracking speed of the rotor that has to be as slow as possible in order that those gyroscopic moments get quite low and therefore do not play really a role in rotor blade dimensioning.
A further mass force can be due to unbalanced masses, for example, by a single heavier rotor blade. This leads to a periodically changing moments around the rotor axis. In order to prevent this, a balancing of the rotor is absolutely necessary.
And finally, we have the air forces itself. We already discussed them in former videos. And first, we have the axial force, FAX, over the complete blade length, and therefore we have bending moments in the thrust direction. And we have the tangential force over the complete blade length, the circumference direction, and again we have moments, bending moments in the circumference direction. So that is the force we are really looking for that makes the power of the wind turbine, but nevertheless, it is a fatigue for the wind turbine.
Furthermore, there are periodically alternating air forces. These can be caused, for example, by asymmetrical flow at the rotor and lead to instationary periodically changing loads. Causes for these forces are, amongst others, when the wind velocity is increasing with height and an inclined inflow at the rotor.
And when we consider all the forces the long lifetime of a wind turbine, then it's clear that we cannot just design the rotor blades by calculating. Therefore, more and more big test rigs for rotor blades play a big role in the rotor design. And therefore, in those test rigs, we verify the stability of those rotor blades. We are checking the static robustness of the blades and the inspection of the critical areas of the construction concerning dynamic loads and also the determination of the most important eigenfrequencies. And in the next animation that is done by Fraunhofer IWIS, we show an animation of such a test rig of Fraunhofer Institute.
In den Testständen des Fraunhofer IWIS in Bremerhaven werden bis zu 90 Meter lange Rotorblätter getestet. Das IWIS prüft, ob die Lastenauslegung des Blattes den realistischen Beanspruchungen einer 20-jährigen Betriebsdauer standhält. Die Blattprüfungen an Prototypen werden im Kundenauftrag ausgeführt. Die Ergebnisse dienen auch zur Zertifizierung der Rotorblätter. Beim sogenannten statischen Test lassen sich Belastungen wie bei Extremwindereignissen simulieren. Das Rotorblatt wird an bis zu 8 festgelegten Punkten kontrolliert belastet. Bei langen Blättern wird dabei der Kippblock geneigt. Das Blatt wird so stark gebogen, dass an der Blattspitze eine Auslenkung von über 30 Metern möglich ist. Hunderte am Blatt angebrachte Sensoren registrieren die auftretenden Verformungen, Kräfte, Dehnungen, Beschleunigungen und Temperaturen. Ein Messsystem zeichnet alle Werte auf. So werden Schwachstellen im Design sichtbar und können optimiert werden. Bei den zyklischen Ermüdungstests wird das Rotorblatt nacheinander in Schwenk- und Schlagrichtung getestet. Ein servohydraulischer Zylinder hält das Blatt mit einem relativ geringen Kraftaufwand in der Eigenfrequenzschwingung, sodass kostengünstige Langzeittests möglich sind. Bei dem biaxialen Ermüdungstest wird das Blatt gleichzeitig in zwei Richtungen angeregt. Mit dieser Testmethode, die am Fraunhofer IWIS entwickelt wird, können auch die Zwischenbereiche realistisch belastet und die Wirkungen auf das Rotorblatt erfasst werden. Das Kompetenzzentrum Rotorblatt prüft gemäß internationaler IEC-Normen. Mit der Beurteilung der Testberichte durch unabhängige Zertifizierer ist für die Blatthersteller ein wichtiger Schritt auf dem Weg zu einem verlässlichen Rotorblattdesign getan.
Materials for rotor blades are, for example, steel, aluminum, wood or fiber-reinforced composites. Modern rotor blades are usually made of glass fiber-reinforced plastic materials. They have a high stability and relative low material costs.
And those fiber-reinforced composites, they have excellent lightweight properties. For example, these GFRP laminates, they have a very low density of only 1.8 gram per cubic centimeters, or have high tensile strengths of 250 to 450 megapascal.
Due to fiber-reinforced composites, is it possible to reduce the required material thickness in comparison to metals by the amount of fiber and by the arrangement of the main fraction of the fibers in direction of the highest loads. And this leads to a better material use. These materials additionally have a lower corrodibility. And their disadvantages are their lower breaking elongation that makes them more sensitive to stress peaks. Furthermore, they have a low fluidity under excessive stress.
And now to sum up, what will we learn in all those videos in this video series about rotor blades? So we started with the aerodynamic design of a rotor blade. So we are now able to calculate the pitch angle and also the rotor depth over the complete length of a rotor blade. We have discussed the number of rotor blades and also we discussed the structural design of rotor blades. Among others, the air and mass forces onto the rotor and the materials used for rotor blades. Thank you very much.